Well, good afternoon, everybody. Here we find ourselves in a slightly unusual position. Not as unusual as that hippopotamus, however, which is lying in a tiny little pool of water. And as I said yesterday when we were at Biffleshook Dam looking at three or four hippopotamus in a kind of very marginal habitat type, so this hippo has now come into an extremely marginal habitat type simply because there is not much water around anymore. Even though we had some good soaking rain yesterday, and has not filled up any of the big water holes. So, you are with Wild Earth. This is Safari Live, a very live, interactive sunset safari in the northeastern corner of magnificent South Africa. The Kruger National Park, western fringes thereof, on a little piece of it called Juma, and to the west of us, Arethusa. My name is James. On camera we have Brian, and Brian is dressed in very summery weather, but if you look carefully just over the top of the hippopotamus, you will see a little bit of cloud starting to gather from the southeast, so he may regret the choice of his summery outfit. It is 25 degrees Celsius. I think that's about 77 degrees Fahrenheit. No, it's not. 74-ish degrees Fahrenheit, I think. Yes, I think that's what it is. It's amazing how long it's taken me to sort out those conversions. And on the other vehicle, and on his 2 feet as well, is Stefan Winterboer, the winter farmer. That's what Winterboer means. I would suggest you ask him where it comes from. I'm thoroughly confused why anyone would call themselves winter farmer. And with him, of course, Andrew Francis, aka Freddie Mercury. He's carrying the backpack, and what was a very slim physique is turning into something of a, you know, muscular godlike physique because of all the backpack carrying that Andrew is doing. So do greet him when you see them. Now, like I say, interactive completely. Hashtag Safari Live if you want to talk to us on the Twitter, like those oxpeckers over there which are tweeting away or more kind of buzzing. And questions at wildearth.tv if you want to talk to us on the email. Any questions, any comments that you might have are welcome, well, within reason, of course. But specifically related to the safari, ideally, and we'd love to hear from you. So, we're going to spend a little bit of time with this hippo. I don't think he's going to do a great deal. I haven't moved very close to him, and there's a very good reason for that. Because habitat is marginal at the moment for things like hippo, it's not a good idea to get too close because they can become threatened, and then he'll get up and move, and he'll probably be even more uncomfortable than he is already. He'll go off into the sun and he won't have any water to lie next to. Hippos are desperate for water because they really, well, they get a sense of safety from it, and they're of course extremely sensitive to the sun. And that means that they need to have that water, otherwise they overheat, they have a really tough time. It's not a hot day at all, and there's a very cooling breeze. And we had a very dry season last year, not much water. That will have carried over to this season. So you won't really notice it in the first season. And Donna, you say you've never seen a hippo in this pan before and you've been watching a long time. Donna, that's perfectly understandable. Remember that we had a very dry season last year. That meant that the water table was low, and while it didn't make a huge difference in the pans, what it has meant is that as the dry season has progressed, so the water has probably dried up more than it might have during other years. So I suspect that's why we're starting to see four or five hippo in Biffleshook Dam, despite the fact that it's only probably about 3 feet deep at its deepest point. And then in this funny little pan here, freshwater pan, here's this hippo. And we were just thinking, Brian and I, how interesting it would be if an elephant came down to have a drink, what would happen? And what I think would happen is that this hippo would move quite quickly and sort of go off in a huff into the bush. If something smaller came along, it might make a bit more of an effort to keep up the pans. So, I don't think we're going to spend too much longer here. Just to give you a little bit of an update on the lion situation, the Birmingham boys were found on Mala Mala today. That's well south of here. They continue to leave Juma undefended, unmarked for territory, and I think it can't be long. If they don't come north soon, I don't think it's going to be too long before the Salates come south from Biffles Hook and from Manyaleti, only to find that this is completely unmarked territory. We've had rain, there won't be the smell of lion around. We've had the Salala Pride coming through here this morning. What we're going to do from here is head up basically to where we saw that those four lions this morning. We had three, the young males and one lioness. They were sitting up not too far from here on the Biffles Hook boundary. And we're going to head across to Arethusa and see if we can't pick up something interesting there. If we can't, well, we're sure to find something lurking around the corner. This morning, of course, we had the highlights of the dice moth caterpillar. Now, if you weren't on the drive this morning, you missed out on a treat with a dice moth caterpillar that Steph found. They are the most beautiful little caterpillars. And then up to the other side of the scale, of course, we had an elephant and the lions, of course. So, lots and lots to see, lots and lots to expect. So here we go, and you are most welcome. Now, of course, our viewers are extremely astute, especially the ones that have been watching for a little while. And Barbara, you've noticed that hippo's back seemed to be scratched. So it looks like it's been gone over by a lawnmower. I can assure you that that is not what has happened. But you will find that hippos will now start to fight with each other. Just like with human beings or any other animal, when the resources are poor, when there's a dearth of resources, they will fight. I think this is a young bull. He's probably been chased out of a pod by a much older bull, and I think that's why he's got those scratches on his back. He's not in bad shape, though. Although, I'll tell you what, we saw a hippo here the other day. He came up, down, and he walked off away. And he was injured on the other side of his body, and I suspect this might be the same one. I don't want to threaten him. I don't want to make him move. So we're just going to do a little detour around him. Okay, I wonder if it's the same one. I don't think it is, no. Wonderful update. Thank you from Rocky Knight. You say a hippo did come to the pan during the course of the day, had a drink there, and the hippo didn't even move. That tells me that it might be injured, you know. That's interesting. Maybe the elephant was particularly nice to him. And we did have an elephant. Ooh, Brian, I think you can get that fellow. A beautiful battalier. It's really difficult to film them because we don't know where they're going to turn. He's going the other way, don't worry about it. No, here she comes. She's coming this way. Female battalier. Extremely difficult to film, especially when they don't move where you want them to. Beautiful bird. And one of the only birds that flies with such incredible grace in such a strong wind. The wind is blowing up there. Well done. Okay, on we go. And we'll have a little few chats about the hippo as we move. And Eddie Abbey, you say that it looks like the hippo that had the injured leg the other day. Could well be. Was around here. And the thing to be careful of course, is if we're going to walk around here, which we have been doing, you need to be very careful of hippo that are feeling threatened and out of the water. That's when a hippo is dangerous. Because they feel very threatened when they're not in the water. And I suspect that elephant that came down to drink today was the same one that was around camp. Came right up, sort of, almost into the camp. I'm going to try her now, Bart. She now disappears over the horizon. Sorry, same battalier, everybody. She's moving around all over the place, and every time Brian gets a camera on her, she gets shy. Beautiful. Lovely, graceful, floating, gliding flight. Oh. And watch them all day long. Mm. Now, I have just received a massively interesting update from Mike, Jack, and John, and all of you say that the Nkuhumas were seen with Junior today on Cheetah Plains. Now, I'm actually just going to get an update on the radio. That is fascinating to me. We're on a little WhatsApp group, and we're supposed to get those sorts of updates. But let me just find out exactly what the story is there. That is fascinating. I really thought Junior's days of being in that pride were over. So stand by, and let me just get a bit of an update quickly. Craig, do you copy, Craig? Craig or Andrew, do you copy, Craig or Andrew? There we go. Good, thanks. Andrew, can you confirm Kuhumas on Cheetah Plains today? Copy that, and is the young male with them? Thanks very much. So, Mike, Jack, and John, not on Cheetah Plains, found by a Cheetah Plains ranger, though, on Biffle's Hook, which is north of us, and Junior, everybody, is with them. Isn't that astonishing? So he's obviously come back home. He's feeling a little homesick. I don't think it's necessarily a good idea. Well, except that those Birminghams are not around, so perhaps it is a good idea. Perhaps he knows that. In fact, he would know that because they certainly haven't been calling around here for a while, and maybe he's snuck back home. He'll hang around with his family for a little bit longer. And of course, that has positives and negatives. It's good for him because he will eat a lot more. It's not great for the pride because he will eat more than his share, because that's what the males do. And he's also been seen trying to mate with his mother and with a few sisters. So that's one of the advantages of having new males into an area and them chasing the existing males off. It's not a huge train smash for lions, though. Right. So they are back in the area and very close to where the Solala pride was seen this morning. So how that dynamic's working is deeply confusing to me. We'll see over the course of the next few days, hopefully. From Schemmel about the conflict that occurred on Arethusa a few nights ago with six hyenas taking on the Solala pride, and the tailless lioness and one other lioness has not been seen since then. So that's quite interesting. I think that must have been the night that we had the rain, and so we didn't go out and across there. So fascinating. Thank you, Schemmel, for that. What's happened to them? They could have been killed, but it's highly unlikely that six hyenas would manage to kill two lionesses. I think it's more likely that they've just got separated, perhaps in the squabble, and that they're okay, and they'll rest up for a few days quite happily on their own. But I do know that these lionesses, the lioness and the three males, came across from Simbambili this morning. So, and you saw how they were running if you were with us this morning. They came across and we saw them. They were running along and looking over their shoulders. It's quite interesting to see what's happening. So maybe there was an injury to the tailless lioness and the other one. Thank you for that, Schemmel. Great update. So this is Mvubu Road, and Mvubu Road takes us straight up to the Biffleshoek cut line and the dam wall on which the Solala pride was resting up this morning. I'm rather hoping that maybe they came back further south, especially as the Nkuhuma pride, whose territory this is really, Biffleshoek today. Don't Donna, you've seen a picture of Junior and you say his mane is growing. I'm sure if it's anything like one of those Matimba male's manes, which it should be, because I'm sure one of them is his father, he's going to have a magnificent mane and he's going to be a good-sized male lion if he lives to proper adulthood. I just think it's a bit of a pity that he didn't have any brothers that he could go off with. But I think he will be a large fellow and he'll have a beautiful mane. His beard. What we did manage to do today, of course, what I managed to do was drive over some of the Salala Pride's dung. And, well, as I've said before, nothing in the world smells worse than lion dung. And every so often, as the wheels turn, we get a whiff, Brian and I. And Brian is looking a bit green at the moment around the gills because of it. Sorry about that, Brian. Attempt not to do it again. Don't make any promises. Many of you know we have these two dam cams, the Juma dam cam and the Arethusa dam cam, and many of you have commented on the fact that there's a very tiny hippo at the Arethusa dam cam. Marvelous news that, perhaps born recently. And Cecilia, you want to know, can they nurse underwater? They can nurse underwater apparently. I think they probably nurse on the ground as well, but they are apparently able to nurse underwater as well. Quite an adaptation. Right, we're nearing the area where those lions were seen this morning. Not sure that we will see them because they were looking like they might head north into Biffles Hook. It's been a nice warm day, really kind of perfect weather to be honest. It's a chilly morning. Afternoon has proved very nice indeed. So let's just look carefully around here in the shade under the trees. Make sure that they haven't popped across during the course of today. Tracks of hyenas. So they were sitting on the dam wall just in front of us. Do you see them anywhere? Do you, Brian? See any lions? They've gone northeast of here. I've just got an update on the radio. They're just northeast of the dam wall. So that's northeast. They're just in the bushes there. So I'm afraid we're not going to see them. We can't go in there. What a pity. Okay. Let's pop across to Arethusa, see what's cutting there. Otherwise we'll come back. Keep an eye on the dam, on the dam cams, especially for that hippo. I'll be interested again if anything else comes down to drink, if it's prepared to share that water with them. Or if not, I'm going to chase them off. The dogs were seen further south of us, apparently today, or yesterday evening, and so unfortunately I don't think we don't see them. It's been such a pleasure having them sort of around about here for the last little while. Certainly my favourite thing to be following around. So exciting. Even if they're not doing anything, they are doing something. Quite unlike their lion friends. Concerned viewer called Jack wanting to know what is up with Rusty and Wendy, and you know, what is the prognosis on their ill health. Rusty today was fixed by the magnificent Opar, who is the mechanic at Juma, and so Rusty's almost good to go. We just got to do one or two electrical things on her, but that's no problem. But instead of taking her out this afternoon, Steph is going to do another walk, which I think is just a great idea. So ideally we're going to do one walk and one drive, and then when there are more of us on site we'll probably do two drives and a walk. So Rusty's okay, Wendy is in hospital having some form of transplant. She's off in Hoedspruit. She was taken there this morning, and we hope and fervently for her safe return in good health. At the moment we have no word from the mechanics as to what her problem is, other than age, of course. Excellent query from Joyce about Junior and his possible prospects and those of the Salalas. Could Junior form a coalition with those three Salala males? So Junior is about 3.5 now, and those Salalas are probably about a year and a bit younger than him. It's possible. It's absolutely possible. Especially if those Birminghams come back and they chase those young males away. They're a little bit young to be leaving the Pride, but they could go now. And especially if there's pressure from those males, it's possible. Yeah, that would be great. And I've certainly seen when the Mapoho came into this area, there were 5 young males, and they had a 6th initially. And he was older. He didn't look anything like them, other than the fact that he looked like a lion. But he certainly was very differently coloured, and he had a very different looking face. He had a longer snout, and he eventually disappeared. And he was older than the 5 of them. And I think absolutely it's possible for them to meet, to come together. So they don't have to be the same age. They just have to be nomadic and not territorial yet by the time they meet up. Good thought, Joyce. Wouldn't that be nice? That would be lovely if they formed a coalition. But they should ideally need to go off somewhere else, because we don't want them hanging around here in the area where they were born, because obviously they're very closely related to many of the lions of this area. So while it would be nice to watch Junior and the Salala Pride males in a kind of coalition, I think it would be better for the lion population if they went somewhere else. Heading due west now, along the Biffleford cut line. We'll head down a road here past an area called Sandy Patch, which is a bit open. See what we can see there, and then hopefully off to Arethusa. We'll get a quick update on Arethusa. There's not a lot going on. Brian feeling that something exciting was going to happen at Biffleford Dam today. One doesn't take these announcements lightly. It does have that kind of success. So we're going to pop over there and do that, and then just come far east. So we're approaching the little area of Sydney's Dam. Young bull who's lying in a little puddle in front of Weir Taylor camp. Because this water will dry out, and so the competition will become much greater. But we'll just have a quick look down towards the dam and we'll head south. Elephant there. You see the elephant? And look at all those hippo. That's quite interesting. So there is an elephant, but he's way in the distance. I don't think we'll get him, to be honest. He's walking off. But you can see, how many hippos do you think you can see? See if you can count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. Oh, that's a lot of hippopotamus. Gee whiz. Mm. is fascinating. Hmm? We've got the elephant. Ah, good. There's the elephant disappearing. While we watch the elephant, as he walks north into what will soon become the Manuleti, if he keeps going in that direction, lovely green verdant bushveld that he's going into there. Teresa, you want to know, are hippos born in the water? Teresa, they can be born in the water. I don't believe they always are, though. I've certainly seen a very newborn calf outside of the water. So I think they can be born in water, but they certainly are not always. That is an astonishing raft of hippopotamus. And you can see now, I mean, they're out the water because it hasn't been a very hot day and they're enjoying just some sunbathing. But they've got that space there, and you will find, I think, that this dam has probably reduced in size by at least a third, possibly even more, over the last 2 or 3 months. And what that means is that the bulls, the dominant bull, there will be one dominant bull in that raft, will not tolerate the presence of any other kind of testosterone-charged other bulls, especially if they're young bulls, young pretenders to his throne and his harem. And I suspect that's why we're seeing these sort of other small pods around the place, and that young bull who is, well, I wouldn't say in distress, but possibly coming for distress, lying in that puddle just outside Juma Dam. Hmm. Right, let's go straight across to Stefan. I'm going to get out of this slightly dodgy signal area. I'm sure he will tell you something fascinating, as he always does, and I'll see you on the other side of that.
Well, good afternoon from myself, Stefan Winterboer, and Andrew Francis on the bushwalk, the sunset bushwalk this afternoon. We've come into quite a special area for me. It's been an area of interest for the last couple of weeks. When we were trialing out and trying to troubleshoot some of the issues around this backpack, Scott and Andrew managed to bump into a greater cane rat's nest. And I've come here this afternoon to try and get it on film. Me personally, I've never ever seen a greater cane rat, let alone a greater cane rat nest, and it is something that has been drawing me to this place for the last couple of days. And we just haven't had a chance to get to this part of the reserve. We are in the far south of the reserve on a west-facing slope, and signal seems good, so we're going to have a good afternoon, hopefully holding thumbs, of signal on the bushwalk. And for those of you who are new to the bushwalk, we are walking around in the bush with nothing and nobody close. We've got no vehicle close by, we've got no support crew close by. It's literally just Andrew and myself and a backpack, and we are walking around in the bush unaided. Now, because of that, I do carry a rifle. The rifle is sitting right here. It's essentially just a piece of safety equipment that I've been using for many, many, many years. And literally it's just here as a last ditch item in case something goes terribly wrong here in the thick bush. We're not expecting it to. My aim is not to pick a fight here today. But yeah, I see a black cuckoo's busy calling in the distance. They've just come back literally 4 or 5 days ago. Got the most amazing caller. I'm so sad, call, and a very difficult cuckoo to actually see, to be honest. And the last time I saw one, maybe once or twice a season you actually get to see them. We'll see if we can get you a view of him. You can notice by the sweat that's on my brow at the moment that it's been quite a toasty day. The clouds that were scudding across the sky this morning have burned off, and we're probably sitting around about 30 degrees at the moment, which for a walk is a little bit hot, but it does mean that when we're walking, we're going to be looking in the shade for things that are lying up in the shade. The shade at the moment is lying on the eastern side of the trees, and that is exactly the places that I'm going to be concentrating on as I walk through the bush. So let's go and let's see what we can see. Hi Susie, you've asked me where an Ellie bull is at the moment. I've got a good question. I've been looking for that bull. It chased James and I around this afternoon after we finished an exercise session. We had to make a two-step away from him, a jump to the left and a swing to the right, or whatever they say, to try and get away from that Ellie. Myself and Andrew went to go and have a look for him this afternoon, and we don't know where he went. We think he went into the thick bush on the northern side of our camp, and we don't have signal in there, so we weren't going to go in there. We'll wait for him to come out again, go and look for him then. Not to say that we're not going to find Ellie's here. I don't actually want to walk up onto the crest where we are now. These monkey thorn thickets that we find on the crests here are not the most nutritious places that offer the most shade for elephant. In actual fact, it's going to be quite hot walking here. So I'm going to just look to get through this thicket, and then we're going to be heading downhill a bit. And I'm going to move this away so that Andrew can actually get around it. We've got an aerial on the back. Come and have a look at this apple leaf. We're obviously on an elephant path here, and I'll show you some sign of some elephant in a second. Here we have some relatively fresh sign of some elephant. You can see down here on the floor, this elephant dung is still fairly wet on the inside, but was made a couple of days ago. Nothing too much to worry about. But what's interesting here is the fact that this apple leaf was used as a scratching post. And this will give you an idea of how much bigger an elephant is than me. I stand 6 foot, I think 6 foot 1 inch, I think, tall. So I'm 6 foot 1 inch, and the back of this elephant was rubbing over there. Have a look at there. You can see it from the discoloration. The sand is actually falling off of this. And this Ellie came and rested in the shade and had a good scratch. And I mean, have a look at that. That's like, that's where his back is. You can have a look at the sand that's coming off. Let me rub it for you so that you can see it falling. That's not the bark of the tree. That's actually the sand that was stuck to the elephant's hide. And that gives me an interesting thought. When was this made? Which is a good question. Now, I'm gathering that we had rain here, was the rain yesterday, Andrew? We had rain yesterday, and it started the day before. And judging from this dung and the sand, I would say that this was probably made yesterday afternoon, yesterday morning sometime. Just wet enough for the mud on the elephant's back to get wet but not wash off. And him having a good on scratch to leave some of that sand behind with enough moisture in it to stick it to the tree. So it tells me that it was probably not at the end of the rain, at the beginning of the rain, sometime yesterday morning. Alrighty, let's carry on. The type of bush that we're walking through here is called Combretum woodland. And it's because there is so much Combretum around. This is a Combretum. This is a Combretum, that's a Combretum, that's a Combretum, that's a Combretum, that's a Combretum. This is an acacia. They've now got a new name, I don't actually know what it is. The Australians have stolen the word acacia, and we now call acacia something else. And it is bad of me that I haven't learnt it, to be honest.
Virchili.
Ah, Andrew knows it. Which is it?
Virchili.
Virchili is the new genus for the acacia. Well done, Andrew. You know, these young people, they always catch on earlier. Another thing that I'm busy looking for at the moment while we're busy walking through here today is I'd really like to show you a Polyrhynchus ant nest. I have a theory that Polyrhynchus ants are raiders. This particular species that I'm looking for is a raiding ant. And by raiding, I mean is a army ant or a matabele ant. It means that they move into an area, they set up their nests, and then they raid the area for food, for forage. And when it's all done, or those animals that they're feeding on close up their nests and their whatever, their homes, they move on and they go and find something else. And I have a theory, I've just seen one or two nests over the last couple of weeks and the last couple of months that strongly suggest that these ants are raiders and not sedentary ants, or ants that just have a nest that they keep forever. Now you might note that we're walking quite nonchalantly through the bush over here, myself and Andrew. That's not the case. We're actually walking quite carefully, and I'm constantly scanning, and I'm scanning in quadrants. I'm scanning from right to left is my habit, and I'm scanning from right to left, from far to close, and then I'm scanning far again. So I'm scanning from right to left, far, middle, close, and I'm looking in the shade of trees where I've personally seen, and in bush like this, the thing that you got to watch out for is obviously buffalo and lion. Leopard you don't have to worry too much about. In my experience, leopard, you see them way too late. They dash out of cover right at your feet, make a big noise, give you a big fright, and then run away. And obviously elephant, which hopefully will make a noise. In this type of bush, it's just way too thick for elephant to be in without making a noise. But what we want to try and do is have a look at this bush in front of me. You'll see how difficult it is to actually see through that bush. Now anything could be on the other side of that. So you'll notice that I will very rarely walk directly up to a bush like this. I'll actually walk around a bush like this so that I can see what's on the other side. I'm also using all the senses that I have at the moment, and I primarily enjoy using my ears as well as my eyes, with my ears probably giving me the most luck. Now, while myself and Andrew walk through here and see what is lying on the other side of this thicket, we are going to send you back to James. I'm sure he's got a update for you about what he's been doing, so we'll catch you in a little bit. Don't go anywhere.
Right, well, we're almost on Arethusa. Not quite. We've been driving very slowly, enjoying this very pleasant afternoon, and I believe Steph is going to find you a cane rat nest. Now, I have seen cane rats once or twice in my time, not often, and he was threatening to show me that cane rat nest the other day, and we didn't get round to it, so I'm a bit jealous of that. So we're just about to hit Arethusa, but before we hit Arethusa, let's just have a quick look at this herd of impalas over here. The little herd, nursery herd, what is soon to be a nursery herd of impala. It isn't a nursery herd just yet, because the lambs haven't been born, and it's not long now before they will be. All lovely colors in the light. Still, I wait for one of our astute viewers to tell me why on earth it should be that impala are that color, because I don't believe that it's for camouflage. I don't think they look camouflaged at all. So I think it's very interesting. So if anybody would like to forward me some kind of a solution to my quandary as to why on earth an impala should be a rich chestnut color when they could be gray like a waterbuck or those pig things, a waterbug or a warthog. Because if you look at them now, the most obvious thing is that very rich red color. In Afrikaans, they call the rooibok, which means red buck. They are so splendid. There's a young male with his horns, and an older one in the background with his larger horns, of course. And an interesting theory behind the black stripes that are on their bottoms, that they tend to get hotter because black is a conductor of heat, more so than any other color. They tend to become hotter than the rest of the fur, and so the ticks and flies are attracted to that heat, And then the tail, as you can see swishing there, swishes the parasites off those black spots. And that helps to keep them free of parasites. And we have lots of questions recently about ticks and parasites and different possible diseases that you can catch from them. And during the summer months, of course, that's a very important thing that we have to watch out for. Ticks and parasites, not any really dire things that you can get from them out here as human beings. Do get tick bite fever, of course, but that's very well, it's relatively mild. It's 3 days or so of feeling a bit miff, and then you can have some antibiotics and you'll be all right. So that's what we have to watch out for. But of course, the ticks carry various other little things, little bits and pieces that will eventually wear down the immune system, and so there's extensive parasite resistance amongst many of the animals here. And one of them in the impala is a special tooth. Now just watch that female there, let's see if she does what I think she's going to do. Come on, old girl, don't let me down. That's it, almost there. Nope, she didn't do it. Right, so they've got a longer tooth in the bottom jaw that's called a grooming tooth, and the grooming tooth is slightly loose, and what they use that for is to pull, again, ticks off the side of the body. And you'll see them quite often just turning their heads and having a scrape, turning their heads and having a scrape. Obviously just not these. There we go. Phew. What a total idiot. And you'll see them doing that very often. It's a little scrape for that special tooth. Peaceful watching a little herd of impala walking through the woodland like this. And we're watching some impala, and obviously one of the major predators that they have to watch out for are lions. And we were chatting briefly about the possible coalition of Junior, the Nkuhuma lion aged 3.5 years, and the possibly 2.5-year-old, probably slightly younger than that, males of the Salala pride, and them forming a coalition. And Barbara, you want to know at what age are they kicked out of the pride? It's normally around 3.5, sometimes 3. So the Salalas are sort of well within their pride. They're not about to be thrown out. Junior should have been tossed out ages ago. Now, it's a mystery to me why he hasn't been, why the Matimbas didn't throw him out. And I think that he's now back with the Nkuhuma pride simply because the Birminghams haven't been here now, Brian, what, for a month or so? Probably about a month since they came onto Juma. Well, they were nearly on Twin Dams Road about 3 or 4 days ago, but they've since gone back south again. Possibly because the Matimbas are around that area and they're still trying to chase them off. But this has been a real vacuum for male lions, and I think that's probably why Junior came back. At 3, 3.5, up to 4. 4 is late for a male to be thrown out of the pride. And you can see it. It's as soon as they reach sexual maturity, they start to try and mate with other members of the pride. And that's obviously when the males toss them out. They don't like the competition. And it's just, well, it's not ideal for genetics when you have that kind of inbreeding. But with the lions, as we've said before, apparently up to 6 generations of inbreeding can happen without any kind of manifestation of defects in the lions. I'm not convinced myself that 6 generations, maybe 3 or 4, but 6 generations is a lot. That's very close breeding, that, and will definitely narrow the gene pool of an area. And that's why I say I think it's very important that if Junior and the Salalas do manage to hook up and make a nice coalition, I think it's important that they disappear and go somewhere else. Maybe into Kruger. Maybe north into the Timbavati. Mike, I'm just going to wait for this vehicle to go past us here. Mike, the reason the Nkuhuma pride won't chase him off is because they don't really mind having him around. Well, it's that they don't mind, and B, he's a big male, so they can't really chase him. If he doesn't want to go, he won't go. He's like a recalcitrant 22-year-old who won't leave home. He eats all the food. He does help a little bit with the hunting, so he's like he has a small job. But I mean, they don't really mind having him about. He dominates at the kills, but he will help pull his weight a little bit at the kills, so he does eat. And they don't register any kind of ill effect of having inbreeding. To them, it doesn't make any difference whether they mate with their brothers or sons or anything like that. It doesn't make a difference. So that's why they won't chase him out. The males chase him out because they don't want the competition. Good one, Mike. Right, here we go, crossing the Great Divide to Aratusa. I'm just going to get an update on the radio as to what's going on.
Cedric, do you copy, Cedric? Afternoon, Ced. Any updates on Aratusa this afternoon?
Okay, copy, thanks very much.
Sorry, what was that location?
Okay, copy, thanks very much. Right, so there were shadow apparently was seen. Now Shadow's a 9-year-old female leopard who we really enjoy seeing. And apparently she was seen on Arethusa today, just very briefly. Then they tried to find her again and didn't succeed. So what we'll do is head into the area where she was. Maybe we'll be lucky, but there'll be other entertaining things to see, even if we aren't. Last time I was here, we had that wonderful dog sighting of 10 or 11 puppies playing while the adults watched them from the shade. And the last thing we saw was them chasing scrub hare. Cecilia, thank you for your comments on the impala coloration. And as amusing as they are, I'm not sure that they've shed any actual light on the situation. Larry, you say that their fur goes with their hooves. Thanks, Larry. And Cecilia, you say God ran out of grey paint. He may well have. I just suspect that he had a better idea than running out of grey paint. I don't know what it is. The best idea I can come up with, and for me it's quite unsatisfactory, is that lions and other animals that hunt them see in black and white, and perhaps that red colour isn't nearly as obvious to them as it is to us who see in colour. So Shadow was around about, there's an area just near Arethusa, and there's a little pump and around the lodge there, so we'll head towards there and we'll maybe see that little hippo at the dam. We'll see what else we can find too. There have been some elephants around, which is nice, but otherwise no other update on Arethusa at this stage. Yesterday evening, we were watching a baboon spider in camp, and Steph put it on his hand and crawled up his arm and onto his shoulder, and I said, Tara and Louise were watching, and I said, you know, these spiders can put them on your hands, they won't bite you. It then took 3 steps towards my hand, and I made a rather rapid movement away from it. And Steph took it onto his hand and then onto his shoulder. And he's got a spider to show you now. So we'll go to him and I'll keep you updated next time I see you.
Link,
three,
Look what we found you. We found a kite spider for you. Now, these little kite spiders are quite common on game paths, and that's what we're busy walking on at the moment, is we're walking on a game path. And for one, game paths cut through the area, but they also make fantastic channels for wind. And carried on the wind are insects. And of course, where you find insects, you find these little spiders. And this is one of these little spiders that you do find out here. And have a look at this guy. It's an orb web spider. So they spin an orb, which is circular spider web that lies perpendicular to the ground, so it catches flying insects. Ah, here, have a look at this. Let me move the bush so that you can see why they call it a kite spider. And it's because it has this square body shape. You see it there, Andrew? Just going to give us a second over there. You can see white on the top with some red layers. One of the most bizarre of the spiders in terms of body shape. I really couldn't tell you why they have this massively overdeveloped abdomen. Only thing that I could think that it is, it's a way for the spider to stay hidden, make it look like a piece of bird dung or something else, just not a spider, and therefore it doesn't get preyed on by other animals. Now what you can see is she is actually collecting some web, and she's actually cut the web. Oh no, she hasn't. What she's done, which is actually quite amazing, that's incredible. She's actually collected a bunch of silk, and what that silk did was act as a massive spring, and she's let the spring go, and it's increased the length of this particular line here by probably about an inch. That's amazing. I've never seen that before. And what that very useful bit of information tells me is that this spider can catch quite big things, because basically that was tension, like a spring. It allowed the web to expand as something big hit it and take up the force of that flying insect, and then obviously entrap it in the silk. Now I'm going to show you something quite interesting, Andrew. If you can come up to her web here, you can see it's not completely round. If we can get it over here. Can you, here, Andrew, up a bit more. You might have to go into the sun. Excuse me, just trying to direct Andrew over here. He's battling to find it in the viewfinder of his camera, where I can actually see it quite well. It's okay. If we can't see it, we can't see it. That is a kite spider then. So let's just say goodbye to the kite spider, and we'll find you a web that I can show you. And cheers, little girl. Enjoy catching some insects. I'm not going to break your web, and I'm not going to disturb you. I'm going to go under this actually at the moment. Here we go. Leave her web intact, and we can carry on with our day. You can see we've come into this open clearing now where we are, and this open clearing is here because it has quite a lot of runoff. And obviously with runoff you get a lot of water, and it's waterlogged, and you can't actually grow anything on these areas. So what you, and the reason for that is because it's waterlogged. Trees don't like waterlogged soil, and grasses will grow on waterlogged soil, but only very specific grasses will grow on waterlogged soil. But you get these sedges that grow out here, and this is one of them. And I'm hoping that when I smell this, ooh, the wild basil. They're quite a hairy little leaf. It is very similar to cassis, licorice. A very strong, when it's young, like the smell of licorice. Now, traditionally, this plant has lots of insect repellent. In particular, flies do not enjoy the smell. And you will notice in of our grandparents, when they used to cook meat, but without the joys of
Hello, everyone. Sorry you lost Steffi there. I think he's in a rather difficult area for the bushwalking backpack. We are now in the drainage line system near about Arethusa Dam, where the pump house is, and it was around that little pump house that they saw shadow this morning. So we're looking through the drainage lines in the deep shade in the tree boughs to see if she killed something. It's still in there. Not a big hoister is our shadow. Check for tracks, of course. So we might be lucky around here. I used the term bough the other day for a tree, and we found karula, and I said there's karula in the leafy boughs of a tree. And a lot of people seem to think that I said bough of the tree. A bough, of course, is a branch, not a digestive system. And I think it's quite a nice word, and somebody accused me of using a word that hadn't been used since 1654, which I think was good. Here is kind of good leopard country, thick bush, nice shade. Of course, a leopard's coat is perfectly coloured for them to be in the dappled light. We're going to spend all afternoon looking around here. There were kind of dim reports of shadow, and they weren't particularly encouraging. So we'll look around for a while, and then we'll head back towards Juma. Ooh, there's quite a lot of elephant activity there at the moment. Check the roads. And of course, the roads now, the rain is an interesting thing. First thing it does, of course, is to wash away the tracks on the roads, and the second thing it does is to then, it makes them soft. So if animals walk straight over the rain, then they leave quite obvious tracks. But a little bit after that, if there's a bit of sun, they tend to form the water and the moist soil tends to form a crust on top, and then animals don't leave any tracks at all. So it's something light, like a leopard, would hardly leave a sign. I was saying a little bit earlier that there seems to be a dearth of lion smell and activity around Juma, and I said that we've had rain and we haven't seen the lions marking their territory. And Ivy in New Jersey, as you say, or as you've asked, and you are absolutely correct, what happens is after rain, lions and leopards and other territorial marking animals will certainly go and remark their territories, because rain does wash the scent off. And so often you find, if there's an obvious path that a leopard will follow, you'll often find them on those paths after rain. And what's so interesting about the rain that we've had in the last little while is that it hasn't encouraged the Birminghams to come up north and remark their territory, and nor has it encouraged the Nkuhuma pride to come further south and mark their territory again. So I think it's rather odd. Ivy, so you're absolutely correct. All the way in New Jersey, you completely correctly predicted the lion leopard behavior. Smelling an odd smell, and then I realized what it was. It's thatch. It's old thatching grass that they put in the ground here on eroded areas, and it just helps to hold the water and the soil together when the wet season comes. Sign of shadow yet, but we're quite close to the Arethusa Dam, so let's go have a look around there now, and then we'll come back past here. Ah,
Steph has found something else interesting to show you. For the cooking enthusiasts, you'll like this one. I'll see you just now.
Now, myself and Andrew came walking down this elephant path after we were with that that spider that you saw us with just now, and we came out onto this clearing. Now, this clearing is actually here because it's waterlogged, and waterlogged means that trees can't grow on it, they refuse to grow on it, and grasses find it very difficult to grow on it. But you do find some forbs and some sedges that grow in these open areas, and I'm surrounded by a couple of my favorites at the moment. One of my favorites of the two is this little guy here. It's called Osmum canum, and if I were to pick it and smell it and describe the smell to you, it is the most intense licorice smell that you've ever smelt in your life. Like a really sharp, lovely, deep licorice smell. Now this Osmum has been used in this area as an insect repellent for centuries. Flies in particular hate this plant. And what you'll find is you'll find local Shangaan ladies and Shangaan men picking a plant just like this, a bunch of them, together, tying it with a string, and then hanging it above two things. The morbid of the two things is they hang it above dead bodies. Obviously, there are very, very few morgues here, and people still die. They'll hang bunches of these plants above a body to deter flies, but the use that I like it for is when you are preparing meat. So you have bunches of these that are hung up in your kitchen at intervals, and they will deter flies from coming into your kitchen and landing on your things. Now, I remember distinctly my grandmother having bunches of plants that she bought from the grocer, I remember her hanging up these in her kitchen. I remember as a boy, I don't know if it was this species, although it could very well be, but the most licoricey, awesome smell. And Lou in FC has just asked us to bring some back for our kitchen in the DRC, which I think I might actually do. Oh, this is a fantastic smell. Anyway, enough of my herb garden. Let's carry on going, see what's down this path. Now, stopping is important when we're walking like we do, and the reason is so that we can listen to the bush around us. Now, while I'm yakking, I'm also not listening to the bush around us. And so what we're going to do is link through to James, who's got some hip hop at Arethusa, and we'll catch up with you in a bit.
So there is one of the hippo at Arethusa Dam. Now that's definitely not a newborn hippo by any stretch of the imagination, but it is a youngster. And oh, there's the rest of the pod. I can see just behind this island. So let's just go a little bit further along, see if we can't get a look at the tiny, tiny one. Interesting to me. I definitely don't see a tiny little one, but it might be that it's just under the water with its little nose sticking up. That's not a newborn, but it's a very cute little fellow, isn't it? Wonderful. And he's eating bits and pieces of water vegetation, and there's some apparently the our zoomies are saying that the tiny hippo is behind the mother hippo.
Where's the mother hippo?
Oh, there's another hippo there, just in front of us there. Maybe zoom in on her. That's the only other hippo that we can see from where we are sitting. Oh, there we go. behind that one. Apparently the baby hippo is behind that one. So thank you to all of you for your updates on the camera. Cecilia, apparently you've seen a documentary where little hippos are lifted out of the water by their mothers. And you want to know if that's true? Yes, it absolutely can happen. And sometimes they will lift them up so that they can breathe nicely. But not always the case. It's not always necessary. But remember, a hippo is not a very good swimmer. So they tend to... chasing the bird. They tend to jump up when they breathe. So in deeper water, they don't sort of float to the surface. It's a bit like you in the pool. You've got quite a lot of buoyancy. So if you sink to the bottom, you can jump up and breathe and then sink down again. And that's basically what they do. The little chap is attacking the jacanas there, who look completely unfazed by him. And that wide mouth opening is a very typical behavior of a hippo that's showing his territoriality. And obviously a little hippo like that's not being territorial, but he's possibly just trying to show that he's a big tough fellow, and one day he'll be something to watch out for. Very sweet. I am keeping an eye on the other one. And those of you who've been watching this tiny little baby hippo, which we, Brian and I, cannot see from where we are sitting, you say that its total length is smaller than the mother's head. That is really, really tiny, isn't it? I'm hoping that she might move or get into a position where we can see the little one. But at the moment, she isn't. There's quite a lot going on at the dam. And so while we're here, we're going to have a look over there to the left of where your screen is. And there are some buffalo and there are also some Egyptian geese. And the geese have got a little family with them of goslings that are almost at adulthood, and I think they're probably about a month and a half to 2 months old, maybe even younger than that, you know. They're the little goslings, and they're sort of juvenile goslings now, as opposed to, at least they're sub-adult goslings as opposed to juvenile ones. They've done pretty well to keep all of them together. They will definitely lose a few during the course of a clutch, because a tiny gosling is obviously enormously vulnerable to all sorts of different kinds of predators. Isn't that sweet? They're all quite sweet. And then in the background, of course, we've got the buffalo. And those old bulls are very happily sitting here in what is turning into a rather beautiful afternoon. Oh, let's quickly go across to Steph. He's got a fascinating reptile to show you. We'll stay here.
3, 2, 1. We've just come to the most epic Tambwati tree that I think I've seen in a long time. And have a look what you're looking at over there, if Andrew's still got him. Is a male blue-headed tree agama in full breeding colors. I mean, can you see him still, Andrew? So right at the top of the tree, he's busy watching me with a beady eye. But have a look at that blue head, that purple underneath his cheeks. There he comes now. You should get a full view of him now. And isn't it just the most amazing thing? I mean, not only is this tree just an absolute grandfather of a Tambwati tree, but on it is this agama. They're quite aggressive lizards. They will keep other lizards away. This is his tree. He will be he'll forage around this tree, in actual fact, for his food, and he will try and get a mate. Now have a look at that. He's just coming to see me. This time of the year, they're so full of hormones and things looking for girls that I have no doubt that he'll prop. There he goes. Did you see him displaying at me? Was he shaking his head at me? That's what they do when they display. You see if I can get him to do it again. Oh, he is fantastic. Now, they'll lose a little bit of their color as the year wears on. They will lay their eggs once the female has been enticed by his beautiful colors. They will mate, and she will lay some eggs which incubate at the base of this tree for about a year. Most lizards actually incubate their, or have their eggs incubated for about a year. And please excuse me there, I didn't even tell you how big he is. He's probably about a foot, just less than a foot, 30 centimeters or so long. So a good size lizard, one of the bigger lizards that we found out here, to be honest. Absolutely fantastic. See, Andrew's, he's obviously, I'm standing on this side of the tree and he's allowing Andrew to come close. No doubt looking at Andrew's aerial with interest. Now they're carnivorous. They will hunt insects around the tree, I think. I think they're carnivorous in actual fact. And all around us, the seeds of this Tambwiti tree are busy jumping. It's jumping bean season. And although most of this tree's seeds have actually fallen already, I'm still hearing at the back of the tree these seeds jumping. I'm not seeing any jump at the moment. Side of them, a worm. And that worm. But before I go on to that, Andrew's having fun with this. You have to, we have to film him. I mean, look how close he is.
There you can see the little hippopotamus there having a marvelous time eating the water hyacinth and various other bits of water vegetation here. He's having an absolute whale of a time. Now, while you were gone, the big one in the middle, which we'll show you now, is a huge hippopotamus there in the middle. While you were gone here, there are two of them actually, he or she made a kind of grunting noise, and the little one immediately left his patch on the side of the dam and started heading over to the adults. But you can see there, just having a whale of a time. And you'll read that hippopotamus eat a lot of grass, which they do certainly, and they clearly also eat quite a lot of water vegetation. They do not eat fish. Now, for those of you who have perhaps just joined us in the last little while, there was a time when we were only seeing one hippo, and that was the anachronously named Bob, the Bachelor of Biffle's Hook. Now, he then had a friend, and she was termed Daisy, Princess Daisy, by little Gracie, aged 8, in Ohio. Now, Gracie, you want to know if Bob and Daisy are here and if that's their baby. Gracie, we're a long, long way from where Bob used to live, and I think he might actually still live there with a whole lot of other hippos now, but that's quite a long way from where we are. So no, Gracie, I don't think this is Bob and Daisy. I think this is a whole lot of different hippos, so you can pick a name for them if you want. And what you can also see is that there's the big cow over there, and she's got a little baby which we can't see, but you might be able to see if you look at the Arethusa Dam camera. And if you can see that little one there, why don't you try and choose a name for it? Let's see if you can find a nice name for the new young hippo that was born a few days ago. I mean, one of the things about this dam, which is perhaps not disturbing, but it's not a natural dam. So there's obviously a great big wall at the one side of it, which you can have a look at. And Marissa, you want to know, is this dam pumped? And it is, I mean, it's definitely drying. I don't know if it's pumped so much as just the dam. So there's the wall there, which stops the water going down the drainage line. And I don't know if it's pumped. I think it might be, because the drainage line that it kind of stops up is not a great big river. So it's well possible that they do pump a bit of water into it, but I'm not really sure. Yeah, I couldn't tell you. I think, you know, they maybe pump a bit of water into it. I mean, it's a massive expanse of water, and for this tiny little drainage line to feed it, I'm just not sure whether that would be possible. Now, on the top of the dam wall, which we were speaking about, are a whole lot of water buck. It's all happening here at Arethusa Dam. And they are probably coming down to have a bit of a drink. Just, I don't know if you can pick up that slightly disturbing sound of what is seems like a dentist's drill. It is just a little bit of repair work going on at Arethusa. So sorry about that, but there's just so much wildlife here that it's worth hanging around for it, I think. Beautiful. Look at them coming down to drink. And again, I have yet to see a crocodile here, but there definitely have been crocodiles here. I know that Sean and Ryan have both told me that there have been plenty of crocodiles here, so never know. Look how many water buck there are. That's the hippo calling. Just keep an eye on that cow and see if her baby doesn't emerge. I think you've got a better angle from the other side there with the dam camera. Then some information from Mark that there was a crocodile seen at Sydney's dam. That's also well possible. I certainly didn't see it when we were last there, but it's quite possible that there was a crocodile around there at some stage. Crocodiles are sneaky, sneaky things, and they move big distances, very large distances, and much larger distances than we think they're capable of. They can move up to sort of 50 kilometers if they have to get from water point to water point. So just because a crocodile isn't in a particular piece of water one day certainly doesn't mean that that crocodile won't be there the next day. So you would never find me swimming heartily across this dam. That is a massive herd of water buck. That's the biggest herd of water buck I've ever seen. Let's have a quick count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. I count 20 or so. That is a vast herd. It's funny, you know, we drive around a lot and we look frantically for different things, and so often when you just sit for a while, things just occur, things happen. That's a bit like what's happening now. Ooh, what is that? What is that bird? I think it's a Wahlberg's eagle. It is a Wahlberg's eagle. You can see how thin its tail is. And it's causing great consternation as it flies over here. You might be able to hear the blacksmith plovers calling. And you can see it's not very smooth flight, and that's because it's probably a little bit windy up there. There is still that southeasterly breeze blowing. Beautiful, here he comes. Now that's a Wahlberg's eagle, and he's putting on quite a beautiful display for us. He or she, could be a she just as easily. But do you see how thin the tail is? That's very diagnostic. Tail just seems really long. Longer than I remember them being, but see what else it could be. pretty sure that's a Wahlberg's. Isn't that lovely to watch a bird fly like that? And I tell you what, if you ever want a bit of peace in your life, go outside, find a raptor like that soaring and flying around in the silence. It's just a wonderful, wonderful experience. Now, while we're sitting here, young Gracie has come back to us with a name for the hippo, and Gracie would like to call this hippo Lily. And Lily, for those of you who don't know, Gracie is part of a group of children in Ohio at the Dayton Children's Hospital, and they lost one of their own a little while back, and her name was Lily, and she used to watch. And I think that Lily is an excellent name for us to call this little hippo. So Gracie, Lily it is, and I'm sure your friend would be very happy to know that we've named a hippo after her wherever she's watching us from. Great idea. So I can't see the little one, so I think what we'll do is probably start to move on from here. Let's move on from here and see what else we can see. Diane, absolutely, this is the same waterbuck family that you see at Arethusa. They are at Arethusa, and I haven't seen them around here in quite this number before, but yes, we do see quite a few around here. All right, let's leave now. There seems to be some swimming going on in the lodge, which is great fun. Not entirely a wilderness activity that you need to share, though. So let's press on a bit, and there's a lovely guinea fowl just up ahead. And just a gorgeous grey sky starting to turn that lovely golden grey colour as the sun sets a little bit behind us. Now we have lots and lots of questions about the great dangers of the bush. Tony in Holland, well, in fact, just before we leave this area, let's show you the buffalo. And I'll tell you why we'll show you the buffalo. Tony in Holland, you say, why are hippo known as the most dangerous animals in the bush? And there, as you're looking, there is a little herd of bachelor bulls, and they're also known as extremely dangerous in the bush. Tony, oh my goodness. Sorry, Tony, I'm going to get back to you. Brian, do you see what I see?
I see a guinea fowl.
What do you see in front of the guinea fowl? Foul, foul bird. Huh. There's an Indian miner, everybody. That's an exotic species. It has a friend here. Now, were we to tell the Sabi Sands about that, they would arrive with a pellet gun in short order. So that's an invasive bird. It was brought out here. It has no place in the wild here because it's a highly effective competitor to local birds, like a sort of starling type bird, and they've taken over many areas of the cities. It originally comes from the Asian subcontinent. Not so good. Anyway, let us leave that invader to itself. Move on to happier topics. Well, not necessarily happier topics. Tony, you want to know why it is that hippo are known as the most dangerous animals in the bush. Some of you are going to get a bit sick and tired of me banging on about this, but Tony, there are no animals out here that are inherently dangerous. There are animals that become potentially dangerous when they are threatened. Now, a hippo is just, once you understand that, you kind of understand what's going on. And hippo are extremely easily threatened because they're so vulnerable. They've got to have water, and so if they feel like they can't get to their water or that their water source is being threatened at all, they can become very aggressive and very upset. And so that's what you've got to watch out for. So they're not inherently dangerous. If you leave them alone, you don't see them coming flying out of the water at us. If we came past you on foot, they might get up and look.
They're certainly fairly unlikely that they would come flying out of the water at us. Let's just stop and have a quick look at these gorgeous, gorgeous helmeted guinea fowl. Look at that blue colour on their heads in the sun. Isn't that wonderful? I think they're one of the most beautiful birds we get here. So Tony, same thing with the buffalo. A buffalo, if you understand what threatens it, it's threatened if you, I mean, hunters will tell you that they're the most dangerous. Well, I'm not surprised. If you're trying to shoot an animal, it will inevitably become irritated with you. And if you don't shoot it properly, then it will probably flatten you. But, I mean, without, in the absence of that kind of threat, a buffalo bull is not a particularly dangerous animal at all. As long as it's not cornered, you don't give it a fright, they're fine. And the same thing goes for the hippo. So Tony, that's why hippo are known as the most dangerous. They do, unfortunately, kill probably more people in Africa than any other mammal does, but that's not a lot of people. You know, far more people are probably killed by lightning strikes or by, certainly by car accidents. And I often reference this statistic that, you know, around the world, people are only about 5 or 6 people are killed by sharks. Of 7 billion, 5 or 6 are killed by sharks every year. That is less than something like 20,000 people a year die falling out of their beds. And more than 100 are killed by your common variety cow or cattle. So, you know, it's the same thing. Hippo are considered terribly dangerous, but they don't really kill that many people. They kill fewer people than cows. Obviously, there are more cows than there are hippo. But it just gives you an idea that, yes, while they can be easily threatened, they don't rush around murdering people at will. Right, so we're still on our little hunt for Shadow, hoping we might spot her. So, a fascinating question. I'm afraid my radio is breaking up. So, just to the final control, I did get the question, just not the name. Petrichor, of course, is a smell, beautiful smell out here. I've got it now. That occurs after rain. And Mike, you want to know what other smells we get here. For those of you who don't know, petrichor is the smell that comes off the earth after a sort of bout of rain. It's that kind of glorious smell that comes off the earth, and I think, if I'm not mistaken, it's probably bacteria that is released from the soil when rain comes. And Mike, you want to know what other smells there are after rain. Well, there's the moisture in the air. Certainly that smells, you've all smelt what rain smells like when it's coming and just after it's left, so that's one of the smells. And then I suppose what comes out is, you know, anything you wet tends to smell a bit stronger because I think the water vapor will mix with whatever is coming out of it. So if, for example, if you're in an area where there's elephant dung, and there's been water, you'll smell a lovely kind of spicy scent that comes off the elephant dung if it's of sufficient age. And so everything just smells a little bit stronger after a bit of rain. What else would smell? Brian, can you think of anything that is brought out by the smell of rain? Dogs, yes, that's a very good point. The wild dogs definitely smell a lot more doggy after a bit of rain. That's a really good point. So if you see wild dogs after some rain, or if they've been through an area after rain, you can definitely smell them more quickly than you would before the rain. It's a great one. So this is roundabout, apparently, where Shadow was seen. But in the absence of tracks, we can't really track her, so it's a little bit hit and miss. Such a beautiful afternoon, if that doesn't matter too much. This is where we saw, I don't know if any of you were with us last Friday morning, where we saw that tiny little baby elephant. This is around where we saw him. A couple of days old, if that. I haven't heard any updates on that little baby elephant. I don't know where she is, but I think that she's been, I know she was attacked by hyenas that first night, but the herd protected her, and they will continue to do that, I'm sure. Marisha, in Texas, you say you have seen those guinea fowl, but in Texas, and you say they look exactly the same, but there must be some kind of difference. Marisha, your guinea fowl in Texas are not from Texas, I'm afraid. They are from here. So your guinea fowl will look the same because they are probably the same species. I know that they've been taken all the way around the world. Everyone knows what a guinea fowl looks like. Not everybody knows what an oriole looks like, for example, or a Wahlberg's eagle, but everybody seems to know what a guinea fowl looks like. And that's because guinea fowl have been moved around the world quite a lot. And so you'll find that your guinea fowl there are originally, probably many generations back now, they're naturalized Americans now, but they would have been from here originally. And that's why they do look the same. Lots of birds, of course, that have traveled around the world on the back end of quite a lot of colonization. I think I've got this question right from Lyle in Washington. You say, what are our days consist of when we're not on camera? Is it taken up with wild earth activities, or is it taken up with other things? A bit of both, really. Depends on whether the cars are working. So the last little while it's been taken up with playing mechanic. That is a particularly disturbing situation because I am the worst mechanic in the world. I'm marginally worse at art than I am at being a mechanic, but not much. So sometimes if there's work to do on the cars, we'll help with that sort of thing. We have meetings about things that we did right and things that we did wrong on drive. That's very important. And we have a couple of meetings about content and trying different things on drive, which you probably don't notice because they're normally relatively subtle changes that we make. Always trying to refine the product and trying to deliver the most entertaining show that we can. So that's what we discuss almost on a daily basis. So that's the wild earth stuff that we do. Otherwise we do have some free time, especially in the summer months. There's so much time between the two drives that we do have time to ourselves. I do a little bit of a video editing for a safari company sometimes. Otherwise, I play the guitar or read a book, or I'm trying to write another book at the moment, so I spend a bit of time doing that too. So lots of different things that we do during the middle of the day, but yes, there are one or two wild earth things that need to be done. Lynn, you ask a valid and deeply distressing query. Where are all the leopards? I don't know. And why are we not seeing them? We used to see them a lot. Lynn, it goes in cycles. It really does. I know that there was a time apparently on Wild Earth when they had a month, 2 months, without seeing any big five at all. 2 months. Not one buffalo, not one elephant, not one lion, not one leopard for 2 months. It just goes in cycles. We see the tracks. We know they're around. Of course, we have had the rain now, which has washed away many of the tracks. It's made the tracking a bit more difficult. They are around then. It just goes in cycles. There's a lot of luck involved. And once you've found them and the tracking's good, then the next day it's much easier to find them. But if you, say, go 2 days without seeing a leopard because of the rain or because of some other factor, then it's going to be very difficult to find them again. And sometimes that can be a couple of weeks before you do. Also, remember that we're only operating on a fairly small piece of land, and the leopards are not confined by our borders. And I know in Torchwood they've been having the odd leopard sighting up in Buffleshoek. There wasn't anything this morning. It was quite cold this morning. But they've been seeing leopards around the place. So don't worry, the leopards are still fine. They're here. We're just not being particularly competent at finding them, but that's because of the weather conditions and a lot of other factors that just, you know, if they don't cross a road at the right place, or maybe the car drove over their tracks, you really can have some bad luck. So it really does go in cycles. But fear not, we'll have another purple patch at some stage. We're going to head out of Arethusa at this stage, and as we do that, Paul Rizzo, you've obviously watched Tingana and his trials over the last little while. Many wouldn't regard them as heavy trials, but I think Tingana certainly did. He was mating with Karula for 5 days, and 2 days later Karula's daughter befell upon him to mate with her for 5 more days. So he had 10 days on the trot of some fairly hectic activity. And Paul, you say, has he been seen? Is he taking a vacation? I think he's probably in the Maldives at the moment, lying on a pool lounger, sipping a pina colada. I think it was a rough 10 days for him, and nobody has seen him for a little while. Good question. Thank you, Paul. Exhausting time for our friend Tingana. What a lovely afternoon it's turning into. It's a perfect temperature. The bushes are glorious green. The sky has got a couple of golden grey clouds in it. We're now turning onto the boundary between Arethusa and Juma. Now it will get a little bumpy up here, I'm afraid. There are a couple of bumps in the road, and so just lift your coffee up with your lap, otherwise you might shake it onto yourself and that won't be very nice at all. Best, I promise. Right, I think while we're bouncing along here and it's not particularly pleasant picture, let's head to Steph, see what he's got to show you. I'm sure he'll find you something small and fascinating, or something big and fascinating, and I'll see you next time.
Well, you caught us at the end of a march to get into some better scenery, I must be honest with you. And I know that James said I was going to show you something small, but that small thing is actually me. I'm going to be the small thing in this particular story. Have a look at what we've got here. This is a monster greenthorn. A true giant out here in the bush. Easily 15, even more meters tall. How epic is that? Difference? Lost audio? Probably those batteries. Audio back. Now, What I was saying just before we had that little audio, excuse us for going in and out of the signal. We're right on the cusp of where we've got signal at the moment. And as I was mentioning, James said I was going to show you something small. Absolutely true. The small thing is me. The giant is this. And this is a Balanites tree, the green thorn, or torchwood. We speak about it quite often, and it's because it's such a magnificent species of tree. They're actually endangered outside of the park. You don't find them easily this size outside of the park. The reason being is their wood is quite sought after, as well as their seeds. Their seeds yield high quality oil that you can use for burning, and so people use their seeds for burning. Now, you can have a look at these trusses on this tree, and this just gives you an indication of how old this tree actually is. These trusses grow on trees. A lot of trees get these buttresses or these trusses, and it's to give the tree support into the ground. It's to increase the surface area of the tree without necessarily increasing the girth of the tree, and it gives it strength. Obviously, trees like this catch a massive. It seems like trees like this catch a massive amount of wind, and obviously they need all the strength that they can get. Now, we're going to stay here a little bit because underneath these trees are quite often worlds of information, little micro, basically these little micro communities of plants, micro communities of insects. I'm gonna walk around. Here's a seed, incidentally. Here's one that's been chopped open, and here's one that's closed. There's an open. You open that, you get the seed that's inside there. Elephant has eaten that. And this is one that's closed and incredibly woody. So hard, in actual fact, I wouldn't be able to split that open. But obviously utilized quite a lot by everything out here, from animals to insects to people, all love these Balanites seeds. But, oh, I love standing under trees like this. You just get a feeling in the sense of peace and age that come with trees like this. What I'm looking for is I'm looking for something interesting to show you on these trees. Invariably, there almost always is. So the first thing that I've noticed here, drop tail. Now, lately I've actually got a fascination with ants. Here's one here, Andrew. That's a drop tail ant. You can see how he's dropped his tail, where they get their name from. Quite a common ant around here, red body with a black abdomen. Have a look at that drop tail he's got there. I mean, it's just diagnostic. And these guys are foraging for insects on the bark of this tree. So scouring this. Have a look what's coming up here. We've got another ant. This is interesting because this ant is a completely different species of ant. And will be on a completely different mission. But if he gets caught by this other colony, he'll get killed. And have a look at how fast that guy is getting out of there. Now, I mean, insects are just another world. If you put yourself on this trunk at the size that these ants are, and think to yourself how quickly you'd be running if you were our size. I mean, they just are. You'll be insane. We'd be running close to the speed of light, probably. No, not that much. I'm being exaggerative. Oh, imagine how perfect it'll be to have a tree house in there if you were 12 years old. I'd never have come down. So ants on the one side, not too much on the other. Anyway, time for us to move on. Let's carry on going. Starting to get dark now. Myself and Andrew. Oh, I have some news for you. Myself and Andrew, the reason why we were running up to this spot is because we lost signal. And the reason why we lost signal is because we went to go look for that cane rat's nest that I told you about. And we found the cane rat's nest. Cane rat's nest. I've been battling with that the whole day. But it was unoccupied, so you didn't miss anything. We couldn't get it on, we couldn't record anything that was there to show you a bit later. But good news is they've moved somewhere else. Bad news is that once again these animals elude me, and I'm gonna have to look for their new nest. At least we know there's a colony living on site, and the good thing is now we just need to track down where they are. Hopefully we can do that in the next couple of weeks, and I can finally show myself and share it to rat's nest. Let's carry on going. David, all the way from Michigan, you've asked me if how are animals affected by different changes in topography from hilly areas to flat areas? And although the Kruger National Park is very long, it's a very tall park that covers very, very many different ecozones, generally the animals that you find, you'll find your common animals that are spread throughout the park, things like zebra and kudu and wildebeest, giraffe, buffalo, elephant. You do find certain areas that have specifics, like klipspringer, which enjoy the rocky areas, steenbuck, which enjoy the open grass plains, Sharp's grasbuck, which enjoy not rocks, piles of rocks, but rockier terrain, or more hilly terrain. And that's on the big mammals that you find. Elephant you'll find almost anywhere. Buffalo tend to love water. Rhino, also, depending on where you are, black rhino like the hills more, white rhino like the grassy plains more, lion will go anywhere, cheetah, open plains. To answer your question there, David, absolutely. I think that topography and terrain do have an effect on what animals you see where and what concentration of animals you see where. But to be honest with you, I don't think that it has too much of an effect in a park the size of the Kruger. You'd have to actually change provinces, change countries to see different animals, see different species of zebra, see different species of giraffe, different subspecies of rhinoceros or different subspecies of the other antelope. I mean, as you start getting closer to the equator, you start seeing very different antelope species. So definitely not on a small scale, even though we are looking at sort of 3.5 million hectare out here. Hope that answered your question. Let's carry on. A very persistent fly that was buzzing around my face there. Now we do have an oxpecker that is trilling. In front of us, and oxpeckers like to sit on animals because they feed on ticks. So we're just going to be taking it slower through this thicket. I'm hearing them, there's two or three times they've actually landed over there, and in thick bush like this, I'm not going to chance actually going in there. You can actually see how thick the bush is. The visibility where we are at the moment is probably about 3 meters, which is about 15 feet at the moment. I definitely don't want to go and stumble upon something hiding in this thicket. So what we're doing is we're listening to the bush. The bush is telling us that something big is over there. Oxpeckers can sit on anything from giraffe to zebra to wildebeest, but they can also sit on things like buffalo and rhino, and I don't want to bump into either of them in this thick bush. So let's carry on. We know where something is. I don't particularly want to know what it is. However, as it so happens, Mother Nature has provided us with a vantage point. I've just been asked a question. I'm not too sure who the question came from, if you'd excuse me, but I am going to answer it. What is the oldest tree that we have in South Africa? Ah, Lady Macbeth answered the asked this question. What is the oldest tree we have in South Africa? Lady Macbeth, that's such an awesome question. The oldest tree that we have in South Africa, as far as I know, is a wild olive, dated at about 4,500 years old. And it is situated in the Waterberg, near a town with an old name called Naboom Spreit. I think it's called Mukopong at the moment. It's lying in the bush, close to a reserve called Entebeni Private Game Reserve, and is a wild olive. And yeah, 4,500, somewhere around there, years old. A massive tree. Not tall, but definitely ancient. Let's see if we can use this termite mound as a vantage point to see what is I'll probably go crashing through the bush over here. As you can see, this thicket is properly thick. And even though we are standing a good 2 meters off of the ground at the moment, plus my 6 foot on top of that, I still actually can't see what those oxpeckers were sitting on. So I can obviously discount giraffe. We'd be able to see a giraffe here. So I can discount giraffe. I can't discount kudu, and I can't discount rhinoceros, and I can't discount buffalo here. So we're not going to go and poke our nose over there. This is just way too thick. We're going to carry on the way I respect the bush out here. It respects me. And then Mischen in Dallas has asked me if I've ever seen a baobab tree. Mischen, I have. I've had the pleasure of living in a baobab tree for about a month. One of the bush trips that my dad took me on as a young man had a camp built on the side of a baobab tree. It had fallen over, and this camp, it was still growing in actual fact, this camp had been put up around this baobab tree, and I had the pleasure of camping as a young boy, playing in this campsite, in this tree, surrounded by other baobab trees as well, for an entire month. It was really a very warm, fuzzy memory that I have in my rapport of or my repertoire of memories of bush trips with my dad. What have we got here? Here we have the evidence of an aardvark excavation. Those of you who watched this morning, I demonstrated how aardvarks dig, and this one would be very difficult for me to demonstrate because I could probably climb in there and hide away. But Andrew will show you how deep it is inside there. Excavated quite old. To give you an idea of how deep it is, I'll stick my rifle in there. You can see it's up to here on my rifle, so my leg at least up to halfway up my thigh, so a good 3 feet, sort of just underneath a meter. That's how deep that aardvark went, almost vertically into here to go and get to these ants. Now, I mean, just incredible how he managed to get himself or reverse himself out of this hole. I don't know, that would have been quite something to see. And would have been looking for termites or ants inside there. All right, let's carry on. All right, we are going to move over to James quickly before an impala ram with one horn goes missing. So we'll catch you in a bit.
There is a one-horned impala that keeps hiding behind trees, possibly because he's embarrassed by his one horn. There you can see him there. Now that horn, of course, has been lost during a fight of some kind. Probably, in fact, almost without doubt, a fight with another impala. Possibly recently also, because as Steph pointed out, they have been fighting a little bit of late because the females are producing a lot more estrogen as they head towards the lambing season. And that will no doubt disadvantage him It won't grow back. We get lots of questions about whether horns will grow back or not, and they are not like deer, so those horns will not grow back. I'm just going to be quiet quickly, just listen to this bird calling. Isn't that beautiful? I wonder if any of you can remember what that bird is. I told you the way to remember it the other day. So see if you can remember it and send through a tweet. Hashtag Safari Live. Questions at wildearth.tv. I'm so sad.
Don't be sad,
Jim. Okay, thanks, Brian. Right, let's move on. So, interesting impala. I think, we did see a few more mammals at the dam, but away from the dam, impala have been pretty much the sum total of our achievements this afternoon. We're going to head to the far east now and up towards Biffleshoek Dam to follow up on Brian's feeling that he had that we might see something interesting there. The sun is starting to dip below the horizon. I think we're going to have a cool night. I don't think it's going to be cold, but it will certainly be probably coolish. Brian has put the first of his three jackets on. Yeah, you've only got one with you.
Only one with me.
Oh dear, Brian, you're going to freeze.
No.
I think the temperature might drop to at least 20 degrees.
Might have to call in the medics.
Yes, we might. So I will tell you what that bird is after the next 5 or 10 minutes. Get in your answers. You stand to win a smile from me and Brian. Treehouse Dam, hoping to see the marabou stork or some such, and that we went past there this morning and there was a really lovely mud wallow that was just kind of perfect mud, like the kind of place you'd want to sit if you were a buffalo or a warthog, and that mud has actually dried up during the day, so there's now no moisture at all at Treehouse Dam. So it's all getting rather dry. On the southern boundary, looking to see if anything's come across, and then we'll head up to Biffleshoek Dam from the other side. Steph, I think, if I'm not mistaken, is probably if he's around where that cane rat is. If you look just over the kind of horizon there to on that ridge that we're facing, you'll be standing somewhere around there with Andrew. Andrew's burgeoning muscles on the back end of being a pack mule for the last little while. Brian, you were just saying you feel like you were getting fitter walking along with that heavy pack. It's not an easy job that these guys do with that pack on, because they have to keep the aerial upright, and that means they can't ever lean forward. So if they want to show something on the ground, they've kind of got to go down in a squatting position. They start to shake violently, and then we smack them and tell them to stop shaking the camera. So it's a difficult job. Ah, right. Stefan is definitely on that ridge. He's got a very nice view of the sunset. Let's go across to him. We'll head to the far east as quickly as possible.
Under the Termite Mountain Range. Isn't that beautiful? The sun has just set. We've got that absolutely bright golden yellow. on the western horizon at the moment. And what will be quite nice is actually watching the colors change as the sun carries on going down. Now, a little bit of geography 101, we actually are spinning away from the sun. So we're spinning from there away to the east. And we're spinning here at a roughly 1,400 kilometers per hour. So that's the speed that the Earth is traveling away from the sun at the moment, which is why you can actually watch the sunset. Is this massive ball of rock and earth and air that we call our home, floating around in the middle of a vacuum, floating around in the middle of our solar system, and then in the middle of our galaxy and in the middle of our cluster of galaxies and obviously in the rest of the universe, and we are spinning around at 1,400 kilometers an hour. That's a bit of useless trivia, but it's actually just, for me, it just blows my mind every time I start thinking about the fact that what we are and how special we are. Andrew is standing where his feet are is where my head is. So Andrew's standing at least 6 feet above the ground, and where you are probably about 10 feet above the ground. And most life on this planet happens between where your camera is right now, or was right now, and where you are right now. Most life on this planet exists between where my hand is and what I'm standing on. And isn't that amazing when you consider where we are on a universal scale? Now, to me, that just sort of, every time I start thinking about it, just becomes more and more epic. To give an example, that ball of orange that we just, or yellow that we just watched sinking over there, is our closest sun, is our closest star, sorry. We call it the sun, it's our closest star. Everybody knows that. What people might not know is the fact that the light that we saw coming into our eyes, so letting us see that sunset, is actually 8 minutes old already. The sun is what we call 8 light minutes away from where we are at the moment. And that means that the sun was pretty much where it is right now, and that was the actual color of it before the light came into our eye. I can't actually remember how far the moon, how many light minutes or how many light seconds the moon is actually away from us, but it's also a considerable distance. And considering that that light from that star took 8 minutes to get to my eye, the closest next star to here is Alpha Centauri. That's 4.2 years away from that light. So the light takes 4.2 years to get from that star to inside my eye. And that's our star's closest neighbor. The next time you have the pleasure of looking up into the night sky, try and see how many stars you can see and think how far they are away from one another. It just boggles my mind, you know. So contemplating stuff like this or meditating on stuff like this is actually quite pleasurable for me. I enjoy that. Now, we shouldn't see Venus at this time of the year. Oh, look at that. Sorry, we've got a Wahlberg's Eagle using some air currents above us. I couldn't actually see it because of the peak on my head. Here's one of the migratory raptors that we have coming through here. They come all the way from Morocco and they arrived a couple of weeks ago. And that's a pale form Wahlberg's Eagle coming here to eat predominantly insects. I just find them amazing. Without a flap of the wing, look how quickly they covered that ground. Didn't use one little bit of energy barring the little flaps on the tail as it soared away, and just disappeared almost in an instant. Very effective way of using energy. Now they come down here, as I mentioned, to come and eat insects. Mainly they come down here to eat termites. So for now they'd be foraging on flying insects that they can catch on the wing. They'd also be landing to make use of some termitariums. What they're waiting for is those first big rains and for the alates from a termite mound just like this, which are the winged reproductive forms or castes of this termite colony, to take to air. And then the feeding frenzy begins. And let me tell you, it is something quite spectacular to watch. They also like to feed on quillia, red-billed quillia. Now, red-billed quillia are a little bird about this big that nest here in their millions. In actual fact, the largest recorded red-billed Quillia colony was found in South Africa to contain 100 million birds, and they ate 10 tons, or that particular flock ate 10 tons of seed per day. I'll just do the maths around that. 100 million birds, 10 tons of seed per day. I would fly all the way from Morocco all the way to here to come and eat those birds as well, if I can get a termite snack thrown in between as a bonus. Isn't it something? Andrew's just done a full circle around where I'm standing at the moment. And we're standing here in the middle of the bush. We've been walking around for the afternoon. And as you would have noticed from that, we are completely alone. It's just myself and Andrew out here. And it's very peaceful at the moment. I enjoyed that sunset. It's now getting a bit dark, but not too bad. And we have some questions coming in from our cane rat expedition, which is why Andrew and I are standing here to start with in the first place. Matthew, who's only 9 years old. Hi, Matt, if you like being called Matt. You've asked me, what do cane rats eat? They eat grass, as far as I know. Now, Matthew, excuse me if I don't know too much about cane rats. I haven't seen them in my life, and I've read like sporadic information about it. But as far as I know, they eat grass rhizomes, or the piece of the grass plant that stores all its energy. Very high quality food, that. But please, I mean, you're welcome to use that fantastic internet invention, and please tell us. I will share it to the rest of the viewers. So if you do have an internet port open and you can find out what greater cane rats eat, you are welcome to send it through to me. You can send it through to our final control using Twitter at the hashtag Safari Live, or you can email it to questions@wildearth.tv. And if we don't get shut out in the dark over here, I will try and answer it for you as quickly as I can. So that was the reason that we're out here. Myself and Andrew came to look for a cane rat nest. And just having a look around here. And now Raisa, hi Raisa, you're one of our regular viewers, or at least you're one of our viewers that asks questions regularly while we're waiting for Matthew to give us the answer on the greater cane rat, has asked, that tree in the distance over there, that big one, very, very similar to the big one that we were at a little bit earlier, that is the green thorn. It's also another massive green thorn. Could you count growth rings inside that tree? And the answer is absolutely yes, Raisa, we can. You will not be able to count the growth rings in a tree such as a baobab. So, and I'm going to tell you the reason for that now, is that most of the trees, including the green thorn that we're having a look at there, are dicotyledonous plants, which means they have xylem and phloem and a heartwood. And a baobab is actually a monocotyledonous plant, similar to a grass or similar to a piece of corn, can you believe it? So that massive tree, that baobab tree, actually has its transport vessels all the way through the tree. It doesn't have a cambium layer, very similar to a grass. And so it doesn't have growth rings, but that definitely does. So you'll be able to saw that, well, if that tree falls down or you have to cut it down, you'll be able to see those growth rings in it and to try and determine how old it is by looking at summer growth and winter growth in that tree. Excuse me for looking quite tense while I'm looking over my shoulder. I can hear something rustling around in the bush behind me, and I can't see it. And Andrew can smell something from the wind coming off here, so we're definitely getting some indication using our senses that I was talking about the other day, or just now in actual fact, about what is here. And it's always a good thing to go and get some elevation, as Andrew's doing for you now, to see if we can see anything. Take the opportunity to just take in the bush around you. I can't see anything. I am hearing some Franklin there, which may have caught my attention. The wind is coming from their side to here. And I'm here, and I'm now hearing some Franklin over there, which may mean something. I don't know, you know, for those of you who've been watching the show for years, and also myself, who's been operating in the bush for years, windy nights like this tend to be quite tense. There's a lot of energy going around. Most animals look on edge, and me being a bush animal myself, I consider myself to be part of this environment. I also get a bit tense and nervous when it's blowing and blustery like this. Alrighty. But with it getting so dark, and with young Matthew not having picked up the answer to the greater cane rat question yet, we are going to be going through to James, who has a dazzle of zebra. And because it's getting dark, myself and Andrew are going to say thank you very much for joining us today. And it was an absolute pleasure having you with us on this walk. We will catch you probably tomorrow for the sunrise safari. Have a good evening.
And I hope you loved that sunset as much as we did. We came up to this ridge where we are now sitting, and we watched the last embers of the day kind of disappearing over the Drakensberg Mountains, magnificent range of mountains that they are. And then we found this herd of zebra, a very large herd of zebra, well, relatively large for this area. And it might be two of them, but I think it's just one herd. And as I'm sure you know, the zebras normally occur in a kinship group with a stallion, his harem of ladies, and then, of course, their offspring. Now, the one in the middle there, behind the one that's scratching his bottom on the tree in a very inelegant fashion, is very pregnant. Not the one scratching the bottom, the other one behind. You can see that her belly is enormously swollen, and I think it cannot be long before a little zebra pops out of her. That's a young stallion. I think he's probably a yearling. Right, and two brilliant answers to my bird quiz. We don't often have bird quizzes. The bird that says, "I'm so sad." Gerda and Raisa, absolutely. It is indeed the black cuckoo. Beautiful bird. I've actually only seen it once, and that was 2 days ago. I've never seen them before. You hear them all over the place. That little colt there has got an enormously itchy skin, having a right old scratch. So he's a youngster. He's allowed to stay in the herd because he's not an adult male yet. He'll go off eventually. He'll be thrown out by his father. But for now, I would say he's just over a year. No, you know what? He's probably almost 2 years old. I think a yearling's probably slightly smaller than that. And they will normally breed or foal down during the wet season. So from now into kind of January or February, with a peak probably in December and November in the Kruger Park. So I would say he's coming up towards his second birthday. And there are a lot of pregnant mares in this little group, you know. That's not one of them, but I've definitely seen at least two. I believe there's a hippopotamus at the Juma waterhole. At least there's an elephant with the hippopotamus at the Juma waterhole. We're actually quite far away from that, so I don't think we'll get there before that elephant stops drinking. But if you are, have you got both screens open? Really amazing that I'm astonished that the hippo is allowing, or it hasn't moved, and I'm amazed that the elephant, I wonder if it isn't the same elephant that is now drinking there, that the one that drank with the hippo earlier. Sometimes elephants will drink twice a day, but I'm amazed that there's that level of toleration, because there often isn't, you know. Often elephants become very defensive around water, and they don't like other animals to be there. I've seen them chasing away certainly buffalo and rhino that come near the water when they're having their drink. They're not very happy with it. So I'm amazed that in that little pond the elephant is so tolerant of those hippo, or that one hippo. So the night is starting to kind of build around us quietly, and I like this time of the day. I think it's a particularly special time of the day. The sounds all stop. There are no more birds calling at all. The insects have started, the crickets and the cicadas. And what I always used to say when I was a kid was, when you look off to the east, can't really, you can just see it through the trees there. You can almost see the night coming up. So as much as you can see the day fading, you can see the inkiness of the night just starting to come up through the trees there. There you can see it. It's the night coming up over the top of the trees. And it's that wonderful, just very brief time of the day when everything is completely at peace. The changing of the guard. Zebra are very happily grazing away their evening meal. The cicadas have started their song, and very shortly, I'm sure, the nightjars will begin to sing, and perhaps the odd owl. There's a bit of a breeze still blowing out of the southeast, so I don't think that front that came through is quite finished yet. And eating, obviously, not the only thing going on around from the zebras. Let's head up towards Biffleshoek Dam. We're not too far from there, and see if anything has come about there. Brian, of course, had a feeling that something would be there. Let's see if he is borne out, if he does, in fact, have a sixth sense. Turn on some lights. Now, while we're driving along here, and we're definitely going to go past where that Salala pride was earlier and hope that they don't, that they perhaps come south and see what's to eat at Juma Dam. Marisha, you want to know if there's a chance that those Matimba males might come into this area and possibly retake the area? Nothing's impossible, Marisha. It's definitely not impossible. I'd say it's highly unlikely, and I'll tell you why. I think they've been given a hiding, so they'll be nervous. I think also that there's pressure now from the north, from the Salati males. And those Birmingham guys, if lions come onto Juma and start roaring, so in other words, staking out a claim, those Birminghams will come back. They're not here because nobody else is laying claim to this area. So no other males have come into this area and started roaring and saying this is our place. So there's no real reason for them to come back. In the south, of course, they are bordered by, I think, the Four Ways males to the south of where they are. So we've got the Sand River, and then you've got Mala Mala on both sides of the Sand River, and south of that, and to the a little bit to the west of it, you've got Lion Sands and Sabi Sabi, and those areas I think are dominated by the four ways males. So the Birmingham guys will have to watch out for them, and they'll be roaring, so the Birminghams will be roaring back at night. And then they've got the Matimbas off and the Majingalan off to the west in that area, and so they'll be roaring there and staking out their claims. Nothing's going on here, so there's no real reason for them to come back here. Were the Matimbas to come back and start yelling their heads off, those Birmingham boys would turn around and scoot their way north very quickly, I think. So I think it's highly unlikely the Matimbas would come back. The only way they're going to retake a territory is if they have a big fight. They could. Now this is purely speculation, fairly wild speculation at that. The Majingalan Coalition has got a very wide ranging area. There are five of them. They split into two and three, but apparently they do join up from time to time. But their area is so vast. They're getting on a bit. They're not the youngest lions anymore. And it's possible that the Matimbas could carve out a small piece of that Majingalan territory, maybe. And that seems to be almost where they are. I think the last time they were seen was on Londolozi, which is in the Majingalan territory. Maybe they're going to carve themselves a little piece of territory there. And I suspect their activities around there, combined with the absence of lions here, has brought the Salala pride up to where they are here. This is out of the Salala pride's territory, but here they are. And they've been around here now for a couple of weeks. They went back a few days ago. They were seen crossing. The tracks certainly were seen crossing into Londolozi. And they came back up through Arethusa. They came through Simbambili this morning. Obviously, they had that fight with the hyena yesterday evening at Arethusa. And they came through Simbambili and into Biffleshoek. So it's all rather fascinating, I think. And if you keep watching, I think we're going to see some really interesting stuff with the lion dynamics. gave the update, or I didn't give the update, somebody else gave me the update that the Nkuhumas were found with Junior today on the Vosshoek. Now, if you're a new viewer, the Nkuhumas now consist of 5 lionesses and on and off a young male of about 3.5 years. And Arcadia, you want to know if he's still with them, because the Matimbas haven't been here to evict him. Yes and no. He hasn't been evicted. There are no males around to evict him. But it wouldn't only be his father and his uncle who would evict him. Those Birmingham boys won't tolerate him either. So he's old enough to be chased from the pride, because he's now becoming sexually active. He's becoming a mature male. And so it's not the absence of the Matimbas per se, it's the absence of a big male dominant area in the area. That's why he's been allowed to hang about the place. He's living on borrowed time, is our junior, and I don't think it's long. I may be quite wrong. Things, you know, as the old cliche goes, the animals don't tend to wear the textbook. Read the textbook. It's my hat hanging low. There we go. Ryan was just giving me a subtle signal by doing this with his hat, meaning that I need to move my hat out of the way, so that you might see more of my balding forehead. What an honour that must be. Maybe I should get a wig like Donald Trump's. What do you think, Ryan? You think good idea?
No.
Not.
Your balding head is fine.
It's fine, okay. All right, thank you. That's very kind of you. Lucky that we're driving along and not looking at much, because Lois in Buffalo, you've asked a question that is not easy to explain in a mobile vehicle. And not for the fading light, I would draw you a picture of what I should tell you now. You want to know what is the size of the area that all these prides are in, and the area in which we're driving. Lois, the Sabi Sands, which is the western fringes of the Kruger National Park, is 60,000 hectares, which is roughly 200,000 acres. So it's a pretty decent sized piece of land. Very small portion of the Greater Kruger National Park, but it is quite a big piece of land. Now, Lois, we are not allowed to drive in that whole area. We drive a very small piece of it, 1,500 hectares of it. So just less than, what, a tenth would be 6,000 hectares, so a quarter of that. 2.5% of the Sabi Sands is what we're allowed to drive on. And Brian, you don't look particularly impressed by the maths that I just did in my head. Yeah. So 2.5% of the Sabi Sands we're allowed to drive in. And Lois, in this particular area, so 1,500 hectares, about 4,000 acres. So we have the Nkuhuma pride, and they use this part of this territory, but a lion pride's average area in this region is about 6,000 hectares, so about a tenth the size of the Sabi Sands. So we don't see them all the time, because they're often in other parts of their territory. So I hope that kind of answers your question. The Matimbas dominate a number of prides off to the west and to the south, and a little bit to the, well, in fact, west of where we are now, but the northwestern sections of the Sabi Sands, not the Matimbas, the Majingalans. And their area is probably, if I was to guess, I'd say roughly, probably half, 30,000 hectares. To the south, the four-ways males go into Kruger as well, a little bit of Mala Mala, and they probably have about 10,000 hectares or so. And then now the Birmingham boys have also taken over roughly 10,000 hectares. And if my math serves me correctly, that brings the total to about 60,000 hectares. So I hope that makes sense to you. Sounds right in my head.
Now, we were discussing this a little bit earlier, and Yaz, you want to know if Junior would tolerate, if the Nkuhuma pride would tolerate Junior trying to mate with him. Yeah, they would, definitely. If one of those females came into Estrus and he happened to be the only dude around, they would absolutely accept him. They don't have any problem with, the word incest is a number of negative connotations for very good reasons, but incest in lions is not a problem. They don't have any emotional issue with it, and so yes, they would tolerate him mating with them, absolutely. The only reason they wouldn't is if there was a bigger male in town and they felt that, let's say a female came into Estrus, she'd want to mate with the biggest, most dominant lion in the area. She might let Junior mate with her to start with. That often happens when they're coming into Estrus, that they'll mate with a slightly less dominant male, and then when the big one comes through, they'll shoo away the slightly inferior mate. So one of the, lions have been painted in many parts of history, and obviously in more recent history by the Lion King, as these tremendously noble creatures, and yet they have very few characteristics that human beings would consider noble. So unfortunately those lions I've just heard on the radio have gone off to the north, so they're not coming back south towards us, but here we are at Boefelshoek Dam. Brian, does your sixth sense tell you where in particular we should be looking here?
Up in the sky,
at the saddle-billed stork. Good one, well done. Maybe it'll come down. Beautiful. Isn't that lovely? Saddle-billed stork, endangered species. Oh, wow. Just catching the last of the day's light. Fun, this might win you some kind of award. Beautiful. Oh, isn't that lovely? Now they're normally in pairs. I don't know where the other one is here. Was it there?
Yeah, they were both
there. They were both there. Okay. There was also a woolly stork here this morning, and he's obviously flown off. So there are the hippo, and we were chatting earlier. This is the dam that Bob, the Bachelor of Biffleshoek, came from. His consort, Princess Daisy, she was also from here. And this is a strange pod of hippo, I suspect, that has come from Sydney's dam on the back end of a fight as the water has started to dry up. But it wasn't very hot today, so they'll rather like that hippo in the pond. I mean, it's not a bad thing that they're exposed to the sun on a day like this. Lovely atmosphere. Just hoping that Brian's feeling is going to result in a leopard popping out of a bush somewhere around here. And then Lynn, you will be relieved because we're seeing leopards again. The other thing, Lynn, of course, is that as we go into the summer, the bush is so much thicker that we don't spot them quite as easily as we do in the winter. And then we get used to that, of course. And the winter comes along and we start to see them progressively more. We don't really notice until the leaves become green again, and suddenly the sightings become a lot more difficult. Right, let's carry on. We're going to drive along the Biffleshoek cut line anyway and just see if something doesn't pop out there walking out of Biffleshoek. They had the Nkuhuma pride there earlier. Maybe they will come south. The Salalas have gone north, further away from their home territory, so it's all rather interesting. Well, all the lights off, yes they are. Point them in the right way. And we will now engage the spotlight, which will hopefully not blow any fuses. There we go. Well done, Jigger. Good lass. Plenty of bats around. You probably lose our signal as we go through this hole. If you do, I'm sorry. I'll see you the other side. stork is still trying to fly. I can see it off in the way. No, it's not the stork. Something else. Birds, of course, now don't want to be flying too much because, well, unless they're nocturnal birds like owls. And as I've said before, they're very... they've got binocular vision for landing because it's obviously difficult to judge distance if you're coming into a tree at 100 miles an hour and you've got to stop suddenly and then grab onto a branch and not snag all your feathers and your head in forms and that sort of thing. So they really have got amazing abilities to judge distance. But that does mean, well, it doesn't. They also see in colour, of course, the diurnal birds, but that means they don't see so well at night. So if they get disturbed and they fly at night, they will really struggle to land without doing themselves an injury. So most of the diurnal birds will want to be back in their nests or in their perches right now. So a piece of wood on the ground that looked a bit like an animal leg. Hear the cicadas now. So we had a lovely sighting of zebra earlier, and again, one of the fascinating things about the questions we get, I find, is the comparison of one animal to the other, and often the comparison of human beings to the animals, and mostly through, you know, questions about their emotions and that sort of thing. And Erlene, you want to know, do zebra protect their young like elephants do? They do to a certain extent, but they're not as successful. Zebra foal is a delicious meal for a lion, and sometimes even a big male leopard will take a zebra foal. So they will try and protect them, and they're quite vicious. I mean, they can bite and kick horribly, can zebra, but they won't be as successful at taking out lions or as protecting their young from lions as elephants would. So, I mean, with an elephant... Remember, the big elephant cow weighs 4.5 tons, whereas if a zebra stands its ground against a pride of lions, it's highly likely that instead of the foal will become a meal as well as the animal, as the mother or father that's trying to defend it against the lions. So yeah, not a huge amount of defense. They'll do their best, but if it looks like push is going to come to shove, they'll leave the baby to its fate, I'm afraid. And they're very good, they're very, very good biological reasons for that. Giving birth in 2009 in Tanzania, and she lay down while she gave birth. Certainly I've seen horses giving birth while lying down. I think most of the animals here give birth standing up. Certainly the giraffe do, I know the elephants do, I'm pretty sure that the impala do as well. There might be a few species that give birth lying down. I think hippo give birth lying down. So some will give birth lying down and some standing up there. What is that in the road front? It is a duiker. How deeply exciting. Or an impala. We won't shine on it. It is an antelope of some sort, heading actually straight towards where those lions were today. The lions have moved off to the north. The north is to the right-hand side of your picture. Obviously that makes the south to the left hand side of your picture, and that means we are heading due west, as you can see, as from the embers of the day are still on the horizon. So lots of births about to be happening. Most of the animals you'll find, most of the herbivores will have a birthing season or a peak of the birthing season during the rains, because obviously then there's more for the mothers to eat, first of all, and so they can feed their young more effectively. And secondly, of course, with the thicker bush, there's more space for them to hide. They can, you know, for the first few hours or first half an hour or so of life, for many of the lambs and foals and calves, while they can stand almost immediately, it sometimes takes half an hour or so before they're able to really run, or 2 hours before they're able to run. And so they need to be kept away from predators and things, and so the thick bush really helps them with that sort of thing. Carnivores tend to be far, far less dependent on deer, except the wild dogs, which of course have their babies in the middle of winter, so that, because they don't really rely on any form of scent when they're hunting. They just go charging through the bush willy-nilly, and if they find something to eat, they chase it down and they kill it and eat it and then take it back to the babies. Now that's much more difficult if there's a whole lot of foliage on the trees, which in the winter of course there isn't, so they can see what's going on. I don't think the boomers have come across here either. Just going to get an update on them. Just find out if they are on the move yet. Is any station though, in the last position of the boomers, and if they have moved? I'm waiting for a response in my ear. Quite a long way to the east. Yeah. Okay, copy, thanks very much. So the Nkuhumas are quite far east now, close to the Kruger Park boundary, again, leaving this kind of core area of their territory totally unprotected, totally unmarked, and after this rain, it's not going to smell like lion here at all. So maybe an interesting thing, maybe the Solaras will hang around. I'm interested to know where those other two are, the tailless lioness, that other female. I really can't believe that six hyenas would have put them to the sword, as it were. I think that's far too few hyenas with that many lionesses, especially such experienced ones. Especially as there were, I mean, it would have been six on six at one stage. Smells in the evening, as always. Fresh foliage. The odd whiff of dirty feet as the silver cluster leaf tree starts to flower. There are some silver cluster leaves we're just driving past now. Yep, a little bit of a whiff of dirty feet. Close to Juma Dam, or we're quite close to the road that we came out on earlier today. And Cindy, you say that the elephant is still there with the hippo. Now we can't shine on an elephant, but I think there's probably enough ambient light over there from that Juma Dam cam to be able to see him. So let's go and have a look and hope that he's still there when we get there. And Elizabeth Ann, you're of course asking a very valid question. Will the hyenas harass the hippo at night? Yes, they will. If they find him there, and the lions, you know, if a whole lot of lions came across that hippo tonight on his own, they would also probably harass him. I don't think that the clan of hyenas we have in this area is particularly big. Certainly the most I've ever seen is probably about 10 or 12 in one space. that I think would be probably not quite enough to take that hippo down. Might be enough if they all came together. So it would be interesting. I would if that hippo stays there tonight, I would definitely keep watching the camera. Just see. Obviously some of you might have to sleep a little bit, which is fair enough. Depends, I suppose, where in the world you happen to be watching us from. And please remember, when you do talk to us, that most of you do it, but some of you forget every so often. We'd love to hear where you're from. There's a brand new one. Must be an idiot. There's absolutely no way you can film this thing from over there. I'm just going to reverse a bit. We've spotted a ground beetle, a predatory beetle. You see him there? Tall. There. Round beetle. He won't stop for long, but he's just rather a precious little fellow who comes up during the night and they go hunting for other little invertebrates around the place. Right, let's not tarry there and just see if we can't go and see the elephant quickly. And I'll try not to run over the ground beetle. You didn't really see it there, but he's got really lovely markings, kind of golden stripes down his back. And in the day, we could probably pick him up and have a look. But in the evening, not so much. So many knobs and things around here. Tom in Holland, an interesting one. While we're shining the spotlight, obviously one of the things that we look for are eyes shining back at us. Many animals have something called a tapetum lucidum, which is a membrane that sits behind the pupil, and it reflects light. And what it does is it helps those animals to see better in the nighttime. We don't have them, so our eyes don't shine at night. And you want to know, is it possible to tell the animal from the color of that reflection? No, it's not. The reflection tends to be fairly similar. I have definitely seen fairly green reflections coming from lions and from impala. I suppose bush babies tend to have a slightly more orange-colored reflection, but I certainly wouldn't put money on it. But that said, Tom, you can tell from the shape of how they, not the shape so much as, you know, whether they split apart or, you know, impala, of course, have got much more widely spaced eyes than the predators. And a bush baby is very tiny and it's in a tree. So if you see them shining out of there, then you know what that is. But no, they don't have vastly differing colors when their eyes are reflected. And it also depends on the angle at which the light hits their eyes. And so, you know, it makes a big difference to the color that comes out of it. We're not too far from Juma Dam now. Ah. Thank you, Kathleen. Wonderful having all these updates from the Juma Dam camp. Apparently the elephant has now evicted the hippopotamus from his little pond and he's now grazing. So we're not far from there now. We're about 3 minutes. There we go. We will shine on a hippo. Well, not hugely, but hippo are more nocturnal than they are diurnal. So we don't worry too much about putting a light on them. We'll do it as sensitively as possible. We'll probably just use the lights of the vehicle rather than this blinding spotlight. Now, one of the things, of course, about seeing at night is that if you can see well at night, what you sacrifice is the ability to see color. And that's because of the different cells that are in your eyes. And so Paul has asked, are lions and leopard colorblind? Yes, they are. That doesn't mean they see in black and white. We don't actually know what colors they see, but it doesn't mean that they're seeing in black and white. So it's not like you're just killing the saturation on a picture on your computer, for example. They probably see in various shades of, I don't know, blue or green or whatever it is, but I don't think it's not in black and white. It's because they lack those cones. The cones are the cells that are able to see colour, and they've got far more rods, and they tend to help with the contrast. Frustrations, of course, about the night is that the cameras that we have at the moment are not great in the real in the really dark conditions. And Roy, in Long Island, you've asked the question, are there any plans to do something with infrared or different kinds of night vision cameras? There are, Roy. Now, the reason we haven't gone with the infrared stuff or the thermal imaging. Thermal imaging is a real possibility fairly soon, but probably not from the vehicle. That might be from a drone or something like that. Infrared just looks bad at night. It looks ugly. It's difficult to do it in a mobile situation, so we haven't done a huge amount of infrared stuff. I think the Juma Dam cam, if I'm not mistaken, doesn't it film in infrared in the night time? Or does do a bit of infrared at night. So that's a kind of greenish color. But the exciting development, Roy, is that there are now cameras that are able to deal with much lower light conditions. And so we are starting to experiment with a few of those, and absolutely, that's going to result in us spending much more time out at night. So if there are animals hunting or lions on the hunt, you know, we'll stick with them. And we can definitely see them much better with those new cameras than we can currently with these cameras, which are great in the daytime, but don't have quite the sophistication that you need to draw as much light as you can out of normal conditions. Right, so we're now on the dam wall. Oh, bit of a bump. So that hippo was wounded, and I'm not sure how badly wounded. It's probably quite difficult to see in the darkness. We'll see if we can't have a look now. And Happy, you want to know if the water makes a difference to the healing process? Happy, I want to say no. I don't think it does. I don't think, you know, the water is full of lots of bacteria and things. Lots of animals go to the loo in the water. So it's full of and things that might eat rotting flesh or exposed flesh. So I would say no, I don't think it has an effect. I think hippos probably have the immune system to cope with those sorts of bacteria, but I don't think it will help. I don't think it doesn't necessarily make a difference to it, but imagine if you had a cut on your hand or in your arm and you stuck it into really sort of dirty water, I think you'd find that you've got an infection rather than any help. There's an impala around there. Let's see if we can spot both Optimus or his elephant pal. Well, not so much his pal anymore, is it? And this is when hippo like to go out and graze. So, oh, there's the elephant. So I'll just turn the spotlight off. And what we'll do is just stop here. And we can watch the elephants just under the kind of gentle bathe of the headlights. We don't want to shine a spotlight on them. And they are having a drink. There we go. That's probably the bull that chased that hippo away. He's looking pretty aware of things around him. And I'll just try and spot the hippo from where I'm sitting. I don't see him anywhere. What a lovely night it's turning into. Little breeze. Lovely insect sounds. Really is just a wonderful way to spend an evening listening to what goes on out here. I don't see the hippo anywhere. So what we'll do, once we've had sufficient time with these elephants, elephants often drink at night, you know. I don't think it's commonly understood or realized, but they do like to come and drink at night and undisturbed. And that's because
many of the other animals wouldn't dare come near the water at the night time because lions will certainly concentrate around the water in the evenings. They'll go and check A, for a drink, and B, what might be snack food there, drinking in the night. Whereas elephants, of course, don't have that problem. They're not afraid of lions. Isn't they lovely? Now that's not a light that's just gone on to him, that's Brian. It's just changed the setting on the camera. It's really astonishing. Even these cameras are amazing in the night time. They're not quite good enough. If an animal is moving in the night, Brian, correct me if I'm wrong, if that elephant starts to move, keeping focus on him will be very difficult, won't it?
Yeah.
So with the more sophisticated cameras, or the newer ones, that problem of depth of field doesn't exist quite as badly as it does with these cameras. So there's a very, very pale wash of white light on him as he drinks water. Elephants very dependent on water. They must have water, and they like clean water. So one of our I think there are probably a few of you, there's only very few of you that have actively admitted to it though, like Shamrock is one of our work bunkers. She watches at work secretly in her cubicle or office. I'm not sure what your situation is there, Shamrock, and you say tomorrow is office Halloween dress-up day and you're going as a safari guide. I think that's a magnificently clever idea, and you're going to watch Safari Live openly at work as part of your costume or act. Brilliant idea, absolutely brilliant. Well done to you. And if anybody else is having a Halloween office dress-up day, I think you should take Shamrock's advice and go and do the same thing. Dress up as one of us and watch Safari Live at work. I think it's an excellent idea, especially in those meetings that tend to go on forever and ever. Good one. Okay, let's leave these elephants. We're going to head up towards sort of quarantine clearings and see if that hippopotamus hasn't headed up there. Going to disturb the ellies too much. We'll just turn off the road here. Righty-ho. Oh, better put my spotlight on again. I saw the Nkuhuma Pride, there was a limping lioness in there, and Miss Jin and Dallas, you want to know if there's been any update. There hasn't been an update. I will possibly get one from Aubrey and Taxon. They will be around tomorrow, and I know that they went to see the Nkuhumas this evening, and so they will probably be able to tell me if there's been any update on that limping lioness. But no, at the moment I'm afraid I don't have an update for you. When I saw her last, she was looking okay, I thought. I think she looked pretty good. And, you know, she was in good condition, but the limp was pretty bad. And, yeah, I'd say she's got a 50-50 chance, to be honest, because if that limp doesn't heal sufficiently for her to be able to keep up with the pride, or certainly stay within a certain distance of the pride, she won't be able to eat. And obviously that means the end, because no one's going to feed her. In lion society, you keep up and fight for your food, or you die. They're not going to help you feed if you're sick, and if you're injured, likewise. Doesn't matter if you're a cub, it doesn't matter if you're an adult. And if you get injured and you can't keep up, bye-bye and good luck. So, she looked to me like she had quite a nasty injury, but she was still very full, and she had just stood up. So I think maybe, those injuries always look a bit worse when they stand up, because it's a bit like you know, if we're a bit stiff, and we're feeling a bit sore, then our limps and aches and pains are often just a lot worse. So I don't know what's going to happen with her, but she was limping pretty badly, and so we'll see. I'm not sure.
Now, this is an astonishing thing to me. This is the second night in a row. And I'm just going to quickly shine on them. Brian, can you get them? This little couple of Egyptian geese are taking their lives in their hands. I don't know why they are not roosting in a tree. They're the one goose that is able to actually roost in a tree. And yet they are walking around in the pitch black darkness in the clearing, basically saying, come and eat me, to anything that might come past here. I find it most bizarre. Second night in a row that we've seen them there. Let's leave them in case we attract predators to them. Now we're watching elephant in the nighttime, of course, and Andre in Florida, you want to know if elephants sleep at a specific time. Not so much a specific time. I think mainly they doze during the middle of the day. They will sleep a bit at night, and they absolutely do sleep. But I don't think they have a fixed time for sleeping. I think you'll find on a night like tonight, they might sort of hunker down and have a bit of a snooze. But in the really hot days, and I think Brent was watching a big bull the other day who actually fell asleep while Brent was watching him. So they definitely do doze off during the day. Excuse me, bug in the throat. How delicious. So they sleep during the day, and then the youngsters will sleep a lot more than the adults will. So although what you find is that you normally find them moving around, and you'll often find the herd moving, but if there's a very young calf within the herd, the calf might be lying on the ground and the herd will be kind of feeding around it. So that's not uncommon. Definitely the calves sleep a lot more than the rest of them. I think an elephant bull, a big elephant bull, probably doesn't sleep for more than 3 or 4 hours a night. I don't think they have to. It tends to be that the larger you are as a mammal, the less you have to sleep. That doesn't apply to human beings, again, intraspecifically. So some of the largest humans I know sleep for almost as much as lions sleep. Quick shout out to the Dayton kids in Ohio and their what should we call it? I think you're then a nurse or a carer, Angie, and it's you who's inspired them so with these wilderness stories and introduced them to Safari Live, and thank you for that. And you say that you had a day filled with happy tears because of our naming of the hippo of Lily in Lily's honor. So I'm glad we gave you some joy in what must be very difficult circumstances, and I hope that we're able to continue giving you joy over the next few years or so. And we're very pleased to have you along board, and even more pleased that your young charges send through their questions. It really is wonderful to have them, and they're often so wonderfully astute. They make us think in such very different ways. So it's our absolute pleasure to have, well, given that name, that little hippo called Lily. All right, everyone, we're pretty much wrapped up for the night. So a quick thank you to Brian. Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Thank you to Steph. Wonderful working with him, I must say. It really is very special working with Steph. And also with Andrew, who was on camera today as the pack mule. To Louise and Tara in the final control, thank you very much. And of course to all of you, mostly for your time, but also for your questions and for your great comments. Stay safe and happy wherever you are in the world. We'll see you tomorrow morning for the dawn at 5:30. Bye-bye.